again to Wednesday Experience. Today is the eve of Thanksgiving Day 2020. I am Pat Bailey, and on behalf of my own family and our church family, I wish you very happy Thanksgiving. In a few moments, we're going to be using our Bible for this experience, so I encourage you to go ahead and have your Bibles ready. The notes for today's teaching are available in the app, so you may download them from there. Thanksgiving 2020. Today, as we stand on the eve of this Thanksgiving Day, for most of us who are alive, this year has been unprecedented. For the first time in our lifetime, we have experienced a global pandemic. We have had to make many social and economic adjustments. Yet, those have not been the greatest adjustments for so many in our community. The greatest adjustment for our families will be the empty seats at the Thanksgiving table. Mothers, fathers, siblings, children, grandparents, colleagues, neighbors, leaders, acquaintances. Worldwide, almost 1.5 million deaths. In the U.S., almost 260,000 deaths. Millions are unemployed, and thousands of businesses have not survived the economic impact of the global pandemic. The impact on our personal relationships has been devastating as our families have struggled to cope in this really strange season. Undoubtedly, there may be a generation that will arise that will forget that this happened, but not us. We will remember this time. Lamentations 3:16-26 says, "He has made me true on gravel. He has rolled me in the dust. Peace has been stripped away, and I have forgotten what prosperity is." Verse 18 of Lamentations 3 says, "I cry out, my splendor is gone. Everything I had hoped for from the Lord is lost. The thought of my suffering and homelessness is bitter beyond words." Verse 20, "I will never forget the awful time as I grieve over my loss. Yet, I still dare to hope when I remember the faithful love of the Lord that never ends, his mercies that never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. I say to myself, the Lord is my inheritance. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who depend on him, to those who search for him. So it is good to wait quietly for salvation from the Lord." Let us pray. Father, you have been God of 2020. We wait patiently. We wait quietly for your salvation. We pray for the comfort of our families who have been affected by this global pandemic. Those many empty chairs are a problem for us, God. Yet, we find comfort in the fact that whatever concerns us concerns you. Psalm 138:8 reminds us that the Lord will perfect everything that concerns us. So we wait on you, God. We remain thankful, God, for this great country, the United States of America. We continue to be thankful, Father, that in this great country, the evidence of your goodness can still be seen even today. Father, on behalf of our families, on behalf of Cooper City Church of God, Father, on behalf of the city of Cooper City and the many cities from which we come, we say thank you. On behalf of the United States of America and the many nations from which we come, we say thank you, Lord. We say thank you for the liberties that we enjoy, the provisions you have made, the protection you have provided, the innovative technologies, the uncommon wisdom, and the community of believers. We say thank you, Lord. But more than anything, Father, we thank you for your presence among us and your presence in us. Yes, Lord, we will remember this terrible time, and we will also remember that your love never failed, that your mercies were new, that your compassions we could always experience. Thank you, Father. We will remember. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. God is not finished yet. God bless you.
Hello, my name is Clyde, and you just had my wife, Pat, sharing with us about Thanksgiving. You have just heard the song, God Surprised Me with His Power, a song that was made popular by the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. I just want to share with us some of the words of that song as the strains of it are playing over in your mind. God surprised me with His power. God surprised me with His love. Just when I thought my case was hopeless, He sent an answer from above. What He has done for me, He has promised for you. What He has done for me, He has promised for you. No matter your problem or difficult hour, my God is able, a mighty strong tower. God always surprises with His love. God surprises. For this second part of our time together, I would like to speak to us on how God surprised the Jewish people while they were in captivity. These people were in captivity, first of all, under the rule of the Babylonian leaders, led by Nebuchadnezzar, who had raided Palestine and taken some of the Jewish people into captivity. The Babylonian Empire was overthrown by the Medes and Persians. And so now there was a new emperor, and time had rolled by, and this new emperor, Emperor Ahasuerus, he was the lead guy in this empire. And Ahasuerus, he threw a huge banquet to which he invited all the main government officials and their friends, and they were having a wonderful time. They were having such a wonderful time that the king was somewhat drunk. And in his drunken state, he remembered, oh, my wife is not here, Queen Vashti. And so he sent for his wife, and she was renowned to be a very beautiful woman. And he wanted to parade her before all of his friends. Well, except when the queen got the message that the king wanted her to put on her fine royal regalia and turn up at this banquet with all these drunken men and so forth, she said, I don't think so. No, I'm not going there at all. Can you imagine how the king felt when he heard that his wife rejected his invitation to turn up at the banquet? So he called an emergency meeting with his cabinet, with all the nobles, and they banded together, and they came up with this idea that, listen, if the king allows his wife to get away with this kind of thing, it's going to become a common practice in the empire where wives are going to start disrespecting their husbands. And so, what did they come up with? They should fire the queen. Yes. Can you imagine? Fire the queen. And so they did. And the king, when he got sober, he decided that they should search the empire and they should select the best group of women, the most qualified women, who would then go through a period of grooming and preparation so that the king would have a harem of women from which to choose the new queen. Well, the Jewish people, they were part of the captive empire. And among this group of Jewish people who had been taken over from Palestine was a guy by the name of Mordecai. Mordecai was raising a young lady that was called Esther because Esther's parents had died. And Mordecai, he did a great job in raising his young cousin. Well, Esther was one of the girls who were chosen to be part of this pack that the king was going to choose a replacement queen for. And as the program went, they were supposed to be groomed over a 1-year period. And after that, each lady or each young lady would spend a night with the king, and he would make his decision after he has gone through all of them. Well, here is something that the Bible said. The Bible says in Esther 2, verses 17 and 18, "Now the king was attracted to Esther more than to any of the other women, and she won his favor and approval more than any of the other virgins. So he set a royal crown on her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. And the king gave a great banquet, called it Esther's banquet, for all his government officials. He proclaimed a holiday throughout the provinces and distributed gifts with royal liberality." The king was excited that he had found an attractive, intelligent woman to replace the former queen, and this woman was a Jewish woman. Don't forget, we're talking about God surprises his people. Well, the Jewish people, the ones who were part of the captives in this empire, the Jewish people were known as God's people. Yes. And as God's people, God had made some tremendously powerful promises to them. And one of those promises was that he would never forsake them. He would never neglect them. They would never be alone or separated from God. And so even though they were in captivity, even though they were exiles in a foreign land, even though they were under the leadership of a heathen emperor, God did not forsake them. And here's one of the proof that we found out. In Jeremiah, for example, we hear God telling Jeremiah to tell these people while they were in captivity that, listen, although you're in captivity, I want you to do well for yourself. I want you to acquire properties, build houses, allow your children to get married. Do well while you are there in captivity. And so they did. And they were flourishing here in this empire. Well, in the cabinet of the Medes and Persians was a man by the name of Haman. And Haman must have been doing so well that he got a major promotion. He was upgraded to be second in command to the king. He was the chief of all the people in the cabinet, probably someone like the vice president of the United States. And as the promotion went, the king sent out a decree that, listen, Haman is going to get a special kind of honor. The king ordered that all throughout the empire, whenever Haman turned up in public, that people should bow before him in honor of this exalted position that Haman had now arrived at. But guess what? Haman noticed that there was one particular man who used to camp out outside the palace's gate by the name of Mordecai. Remember that name? Mordecai, Esther's uncle. And Mordecai, as a Jewish man, would not bow. And the word spread, and the other Jewish people in the community, they would not bow. Oh my goodness, Haman was incensed. Why will these people not bow? Because the Jewish people, they had a covenant with God that they will not bow to any human being, or they will not bow down to any other god. Well, that didn't sit well with Haman. No way. And Haman complained to the king that Mordecai, this Jewish guy outside the palace gate, and all the other Jews in the empire would not bow down before him. And they came up with a plan. They came up with a plan to punish these Jewish people. And the plan was that they would send out this decree to say that on a certain date down the road, all the Jewish people in the empire were going to be killed because of insubordination. They were going to be murdered, executed. Haman's plan was to annihilate the Jewish nation out of the empire. Well, my friends, Haman did not realize what he was doing, who he was dealing with. Mordecai got wind of it. Mordecai got wind of it, and the Bible says in Esther chapter 4 that Mordecai went down in mourning in sackcloth and ashes, and when the word got out to other Jewish people in the community, they went on a major fasting, and they would not stop praying and fasting about it. Sackcloth and ashes. Well, when Esther, who is now Queen Esther, in the palace, when she heard that her uncle is outside in the streets parading in sackcloth and ashes, she sent close to him and tell him that, clean up yourself, you can't do that, you're an embarrassment. And he sent a copy of the edict to Esther. And he asked the servant to explain to Esther that, listen, your people, your Jewish people of which you are a part, we are about to be annihilated. We are about to be mass executed. And you are in a position to help us. You need to go to the king and ask for mercy. Well, what do you think Esther did? Esther sent a message back to her uncle Mordecai and said, are you crazy? Everybody in this empire knows that nobody goes to the king, no matter how important it is, unless the king requests you to meet with him. And as much as I am the queen around here, I have not been requested to have an audience with the king for 30 days. No way, Mordecai, am I going to risk my life, because if you do that, you will be killed without trial. And now we come to a very important part of the story. In Esther 4, verse 14, this is the message that Mordecai sends back to Esther. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows, but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. Remember, God always surprises his people. And the surprise is not always known to people while it is still in the making. When Esther got that message from her uncle Mordecai, the Bible tells us that Esther sent a message back to him and said, okay, I want you to ask some people to join with me. And for 3 days, we are going to fast. We are going to seek God. We are going to trust God that I will have the courage to go and speak to the king without him inviting me. And after 3 days of fasting, Esther got dressed up and she went out into the court. And there she was, and the king saw her. Remember in chapter 2, we said that the king found her to be very attractive. So although she did not have an appointment, although she was not invited by the king, he called her over and he said, Esther, it's good to see you, my queen. What is it that I can do for you? Esther said, Your Majesty, I have prepared a banquet this afternoon just for you and your most highly placed noble, Haman. Will you both join me at this banquet? And the king said, sure, I'll do anything for you. And at the banquet, you can ask me for anything you want. I will give you even half of the kingdom. God surprised you with his power. At the banquet, here is Haman feeling very honored that the queen would only invite the king and himself to the banquet. And things were going beautifully. And then the king said to Esther, "What is it that you want me to do for you?" And she said, "King, well, I'm so very happy that you and Haman were able to come to the banquet. But I would like to have a second banquet, a bigger one, tomorrow. And the only guests I would like to have are you and Haman. Will you join me tomorrow at that other banquet? And at that banquet, I will tell you my request." Well, as things went, the second banquet came around. But overnight, Haman had a conversation with his wife and shared with her how annoyed he is that Mordecai will not bow. And his wife gave him an idea. She said, "What are you wasting your time with this Mordecai for? Just you make a pole out into the city square and you will hang him there until he dies." So Haman made sure that that was done. Here they are at the second banquet the next day. And so the king turned to her and he said, "Now, Esther, what is it that you will have me to do for you?" Drum roll. She said, "King, it has come to my attention that there is a royal declaration that is going to lead to the killing of my people here in your empire. All of my people are going to be killed because of this royal declaration." The king said, "What? Who would want to kill my queen's family and relatives and people?" And she said, "No one but Haman." Wow, you could hear the pin drop in the room. The surprise is beginning to unfold, my friend. Haman is the one who is plotting to kill off all the queen's family. The king got up in anger and he walked outside of the room to get some fresh air. But while he was gone, Haman realized that his days are numbered. Haman realized that the king was going to come back in the room and order that he be killed. And so Haman decided that in a last-ditch effort, he was going to beg the queen to ask the king to forgive him, to have mercy on him, to cancel the penalty. And so here she was on the couch, and Haman threw himself on the couch, begging her for mercy. And guess what? In walks the king, and he sees Haman in that position. Well, the Bible says that he thought that Haman was molesting the queen. So he said, "On top of you planning to kill the queen's family, you are also molesting the queen, the woman who I have chosen as my queen? That's it, Haman. You are going to be killed. You are going to be killed." And as a matter of fact, the same pole that you had raised up out in the city square to kill Mordecai, you are going to be hung from that pole until you die. That was just part one, because the declaration had gone out. And then the king realized what was the first problem that Esther had pointed out to him. And so you know what the king did? He had to write another declaration and send it out across the empire, canceling the first declaration against the people of Israel, the Hebrews, Esther's family and friends. My friend, understand what Isaiah said in Isaiah 55 and verse 8, that when God is doing his things, God says, "My thoughts are higher than your thoughts, and your ways are far different from my ways." The way God works things out, the way how God operates, we cannot fathom it until everything is revealed. We don't know what God is doing behind the scene for his people. people, but remember what God had said to the children of Israel. He says to the Christians today, he says to everyone who is born again, everyone who is a member of the family of God, that listen, I will never abandon you. I will never neglect you. I will never forsake you. And when you are in trouble, trust me as your God that I will be there to deliver you. I will be there to deliver you. And my friends, that's the great thing about God, that the way he delivers his people time and time and time again, because of his grace, because of his love, because of his mercy, the way he does it is always a surprise to his people. Always a surprise, because God is a creative God. God is a God who is so creative that he doesn't have to deliver you two times the same way. Esther and Mordecai had no clue how things were going to work out, but she fasted and prayed along with other people. And by doing so, they put their solid trust in God and they depended on God to work things out. How things were going to work out, they would never have predicted it. But God surprised his people. You know, right now I'm thinking of Romans 8. And verse 28, a verse that speaks so eloquently of how God operates, where it says that all things work together for good for those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. Aha, let me give you an idea of what God is talking about when he says all things work together for good. Remember Joseph in Genesis? Joseph, who was hated by 10 of his brothers, his older brothers. Joseph, who was the favorite of their father Jacob. The same Joseph who had dreams that his family were all going to bow down before him. Well, that was a Joseph who was captured by his brother and sold into Midianites, who took him to Egypt, far away from his homeland, and sold him as a slave while his father was told that Joseph had died. And for 22 years, Joseph moved from being a slave to prison. Eventually, he landed in Pharaoh's palace, working as second in command, because Joseph had interpreted a dream that the king had, that there would be 7 years of plenty and a worldwide 7 years of famine. 22 years later, Joseph's family, who thought and told their father that their brother Joseph was dead, came to Egypt to buy food. And on their second or third trip, Joseph eventually revealed to them, I am Joseph. I am Joseph who God has raised up to be a blessing to you. And he invited all of his family to come and live in Egypt. They got the best land and they were well taken care of. But Jacob died, and after Jacob died, the brothers were feeling that now that their dad is dead, Joseph is going to take his full revenge. And they were scared. The Bible says in Genesis 50 that Joseph looked on his brother, looked on his brothers, and he said to them, fellas, what you meant for evil 20 plus years ago when you sold me to the Midianites, what you meant for evil to get rid of me, God meant it for good. Did you hear what I say? Joseph said, what is meant for evil against a child of God, God turns it around for good. We are living in an era, as Pat spoke about, in a cruel pandemic. Christians have been dying. Non-Christians have been dying. People are suffering because of the pandemic. But my friends, I'm here to tell you that God has not forgotten his people. God has not forsaken you. There are some Christians who have lost their jobs. Some Christians who are sick, lost loved ones, whatever it is. God has not forgotten you. God is very cognizant of the diabolical efforts of the enemy against his people. And while Satan thinks that he is in charge, while Satan thinks that he has the upper hand, God is working things out for your good. God is coming up with a surprise. The Bible calls it a blessing, supernatural blessing. I just want to say that God is going to surprise you with his power. He is going to surprise you with his grace. God is not the God who has forgotten you. He never forgot the Jewish people who, although they were in exile, he never forgot Esther, who was the queen in that empire. He never forgot Mordecai. He never forgot them. And at the right time, just when they were facing mass execution, God turned up with a big surprise. Maybe the pandemic is just one of the issues that you're dealing with. Maybe you're dealing with other major issues, other critical issues that make you think that God has forgotten you. My friend, I'm here to tell you, God still remembers you. Your name is still on his book. You are still on his agenda. You are still important to him. And today, I want you to know, and I'm not saying this to make you feel good, I am saying this as truth from the Bible, that God has a surprise on the way for you. Maybe you have sat and listened to both of us sharing this evening with you. And maybe you might not be a child of God. Maybe you don't know what it is to trust the God who surprises. Maybe you don't know what it is to be able to say, thank you, God, for all that you have done for me. Well, today is your day that you can correct that. Today is your day where you can be able to come into a relationship with Jesus so that when you gather with your family and around the Thanksgiving table, one of the things that you will be able to say is, I thank God for redeeming me, for changing me, for coming into my life. If that is your desire, then I'm going to pray for you even as we bring this to a close. Father, we celebrate your goodness. We thank you that you're a God of surprises, that you don't have flippant surprises. Every surprise that you bring into our lives is intentional, is deliberate. It is meant to counteract the plans and efforts of the enemy against your people. Just as you did for Esther and Mordecai and the Jewish people in the Medes and Persian Empire in that era. And God, today we want to pray for those of our friends who have been listening and who do not know you as Savior, who do not know what it is to expect a surprise from God. Today we pray for them. And even now, as they are contemplating, we ask you that the Holy Spirit will help them to commit their lives to you, to choose to live for you, to invite you into their heart and lives, and that you will transform them and make all the difference. God, we pray also for those of our friends who are going through difficulties. Real struggles, health problems, fear about the pandemic, all kinds of things that come at your people. We pray for these, our brothers and sisters, and we ask you, God, in the name of Jesus, and by your grace and by your mercy, that you will relieve them. You will relieve them, Lord Jesus, of the challenges that they are facing, and you will bring them the surprise that they need for a best life experience. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. My friend, I have two things I want to share with you as we close. One, If while I was praying, you in your own way, you prayed and you gave your heart to Jesus, you invited him to come into your life and transform you, then we want to say great, congratulations. And we would like you to tell us about it. So if you would take up your cell phone and you would text the word forgive to 954-951-4747. All you have to do is to type in the word forgive and you hit send. That text message will come to us. And believe me when I say to you, we will send out to you some very important resources that you will need to give you the assurance that you are a child of God and be able to guide you into making your next steps based on your newest decision. Or you may be one of those persons who are, you are already a child of God, but you need someone to pray with you because of some difficulties that you're facing, regardless of the difficulties. Well, I ask you to pick up your phone anytime, night or day. We have this line open 24 hours a day, and you will call 1-844-680-7729. I repeat, 1-844-680-PRAY. Well, thank you so much, my friend, for sharing this evening with my wife, Pat, and myself. And as she said before, you can't hear it too often. On behalf of your family and friends here at Cooper City Church of God, we say to you very respectfully and sincerely, Happy Thanksgiving 2020. Be safe, enjoy your time with your family, and we look forward to seeing you again here real soon. God bless you.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Darkest nights, you are close like no one.